Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now we're glad to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. I do hope that you in the radio listen audience are enjoying the good music in the beginning of the program today, and that you get on the phone and call someone and have them to tune in and get the message and the music that's coming up. We're hoping to be a real inspiration to everyone. Now to the visitors here in the auditorium, we're glad to have you here. I hope you come back and see us again. And we welcome everyone today. And may God bless you. Now this is Preacher Edward speaking. We'll now turn the service over to Paul, and he'll direct the song service. I'd like to say we're coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. So Paul will take over at this time.
Everyone get the hymnal and turn to page 151.
Your Bibles, turn, would you please, to John chapter 3 for the reading of God's Word today. I'd like to say to you in the radio listen audience, if you're not getting our daily broadcast, if you tune to the station where you're now listening at 12 o'clock noon each day, you can get the daily broadcast. We have some visitors here from Greenwood, South Carolina, and they say, "Preacher, we listen to it over there every day." And so I appreciate that, and I hope you'll tell others about it, and that you will listen to the daily broadcast as well as the Sunday broadcast if you can't be in church on Sunday. This is a faith ministry, and the only way we can stay on the air is by you that love God and can see the need of this ministry and appreciate this ministry and write to him and stand by this whole mission work. I meet multitudes that say, "Preach Edwards, we enjoy your program." But you'd be surprised how very few ever help out financially. Sometimes the load gets pretty heavy. And I believe this is a real home mission work, that you're getting good done, that lasts forever, and you'll end up treasures in heaven as you stand by this home mission work. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. You know, there's always a way to do things, the right way and the wrong way. Someone was telling me yesterday about this man digging a well. And he dug the well upside down and fell out and broke his neck. Now that's something, isn't it? There's always a way to do things, whatever you're doing, regardless of what it is, it needs to be done right. And so whatever you do, do it right. Old Dr. Bob Jones Sr. used to say, do right if the stars fall. And whether you're digging a well or whatever you're doing, do it right. In John chapter 3, beginning with verse 1, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Notice the little verb be. He must be born again. It must be done by the power of another. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not, I said unto thee, ye must be born again. Now we find in the Bible, over in the book of Psalms, the Bible tells us there in Psalms chapter 87, verse 6, the Lord shall count when he writeth up the people that this man was born there. God knows exactly where you were born the first time and where you were born the second time, if you've been born the second time. Simon Peter in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 23 said, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible by the word of God that liveth and abideth forever. 42 years ago on yesterday, I made a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ yonder in the city of Greenville, South Carolina. That was on October the 24th, 1940. I was born the first time over here in Madison County, not very far from Danielsville and Coma, in a little community called the Old Bullock's Mill Community, there in a little farmhouse. That's where I was born the first time. The house has been torn down. Also, I was born the second time in my home in the city of Greenville, South Carolina. That house also has been torn down, and business been erected there. But God knows the spot where I was born the first time and where I was born the second time. Now you're born the first time to die, you're born the second time to live. Now if you've never been born the second time, you'd be better off. That is, if you die not having been born the second time, you'd been better off if you had never been born the first time. It's very important, very essential, that you be born the second time. Now this Bible has a lot to say about the new birth. And if you notice in the reading of the scripture, Jesus here is talking not to a crackpot, not to ignoramus, but he's talking to an intelligent man, a religious man, a ruler of the Jews. This man was very, very proud. He was a descendant of Abraham. He was proud of his race. And Jesus looked this man in the face and said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. So I don't care who you are, what your standing in life might be, politically or any other way, you'll have to be born the second time or you'll go to hell, as certain as you're listening to the sound of my voice today. Jesus said it's an absolute must that you be born again. He said you cannot see the kingdom of heaven, you can't enter into the kingdom of God unless you're born again. So the new birth takes place the moment you're saved. It is the Spirit of God that births you into the family of God. The only way you can get into the family of God is through a birth. That was the only way you could get into your immediate family, through a birth. I came into the Edwards family through a birth. My mother gave birth to me, and I was a heavyweight when I was born. I weighed 3.5 pounds. I turned out to be the biggest Edwards in the whole generation weight-wise, and I'm not really proud of that. But I was the smallest one when I was born. weighed 3.5 pounds. They put me on a pillar so they could find me the next time they looked for me. And they shook their heads and said, he'll never live. He won't make it. I was a terrible looking little creature. And they said, that child will never make it. And one of my aunts told my mother, said, I'm sorry to tell you, but he won't make it. And I'm still here, and that's been several years ago. And I grew up to be the biggest one in the whole Edwards crowd that I know anything about. That is physically. And so you never know. You can't look at something when it's born, whether it be the first time or the second time, and tell what God might do through that individual or with that individual. And so I was born then the second time later on. Now you must get out of the human family and get into God's family by a spiritual birth. Now we have what is known today as the kingdom of minerals. Down in the earth you have minerals. Then you have what is known as the vegetable kingdom. You have what is known as the animal kingdom. You have what is known as the human kingdom. You have what is known as the kingdom of God. Now to elevate something out of a mineral kingdom into a vegetable kingdom, it would take the power of God to do so. To elevate something out of the vegetable kingdom into the animal kingdom would take the power of God. To elevate something out of the animal kingdom into the human kingdom, it would take the power of God. A cow cannot become a man unless God made that cow a man. If you're saved today, if you have been born again, a miracle has taken place in your heart and life that elevated you, positionally speaking, out of the human family into God's family. And you belong to the family of God. In the Gospel of John chapter 1, the Bible says, to as many as receive him, them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. He said, born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but you must be born of God. The second birth is entirely of the Spirit of God and the Word of God. Now I'm going to tell you hurriedly what the new birth is not. And if you're leaning on one of these crutches, you need to throw them away and lean on God. The new birth is not church membership. You can join all the local assemblies you please and still die and go to hell. Church membership is not the new birth. We have multitudes and multitudes of church members today just as lost as any sinner that's never entered into a church building. Joining the church will not make you a child of God any more than walking into a garage will make you an automobile. Now, beloved, you do not get in the family of God by joining a local assembly. You do not get in the family of God by water baptism. Now you're saved by the grace of God through faith in Jesus Christ, plus nothing, minus nothing. There's not enough water in the Atlantic Ocean to wash away one sin. Water baptism is not intrinsic to salvation. You must remember, salvation is by the grace of God and is a gift of God. You're baptized in water after you're saved and not to be saved. Water baptism is for believers only. Now you may say, Preach Edwards, didn't you read in the Bible there in John 3 where it says born of the water and born of the Spirit? Yes, I read that. But you must know what God is talking about. That has a twofold meaning. You must be born of the water and of the Spirit. That is the biggest part of your body, the biggest percentage of your body is made up of water. When you're born into your immediate family, that is a water birth. Now you mothers that's given birth to children, you know about the water birth. That is a water birth when you're born into your immediate family. Not only that, but the water here is symbolic of the Word of God. The Bible speaks about the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. The Bible says born again of the Word of God, which is the seed of God. And so it's the Word of God, which is the seed of God and the Spirit of God that produces the new birth in your heart and life. The Word of God is the seed of God. The man of God preaches the Word, which is the seed. I'm preaching the Word of God today, and then it's the Holy Spirit, which is the mother side of God in that sense, that takes the Word of God and places the Word of God in the womb of the heart, and there regenerates you, quickens you, makes you alive, and births you into the family of God. That is an act of the Spirit of God by the Word of God. You can't anymore be saved apart from the Word of God, which is the seed of God, than you can go out and reap some grain where you've never sown the seed. The seed must be sown. The Word of God is the seed of God, and the Holy Spirit of God takes the seed of God and plants that in your heart and regenerates you, quickens you, makes you alive, and you become alive spiritually, and you become a child of God that very moment. That is the new birth. You must be born twice or you'll go to hell, as certain as I'm speaking to you today. Now you have some today that say, well, unless you belong to our particular denomination or our religion, then you won't make it. Religion has nothing to do with it. Denomination has nothing to do with it. You are born again by the Word of God and the Spirit of God, apart from any religion or any denomination or church affiliation. This is entirely of God, a quickening act of God by the Spirit of God. And if you haven't had that experience, you're as lost as any sinner that ever walked in shoe leather. Now we know the new birth then is not baptism. You're baptized after you're saved. If you teach you have to be baptized to help save you, you're teaching heresy, you're teaching false doctrine, and you'll answer to God for it in the day of judgment. Keeping the law is not the new birth. Joining some worldly society is not the new birth. You can join all the clubs and lodges, the moose, the goose, and the gander, the turkey buzzards, and all the rest of them, and die and go as straight to hell as a Martin to his gourd. Joining clubs and lodges will not get you to heaven or send you to hell so quick until you don't know what it's all about. You need to repent and believe on Jesus Christ in order to be born again. Keeping the golden rule is not the new birth. Reformation is not the new birth. Somebody said, well, I think what I'll do, I'll just do a little better. I'll reform and I quit cussing out loud and quit whipping my wife and stay away from the beer, Jordan. And then I think I'll just do that and I'll be ready to go. No, you won't. That'll not get you to heaven. You can reform and live a life as clean as a hound's tooth and die and go to hell when you leave this world. Reformation nor education is the new birth. Neither one. They are good in their place, but that is not the new birth. Now you may say, preach, Edwards, what is that new birth? Well, I've been explaining it to you right along. The new birth is a birth, an act of God to put you in a family. And the family that God puts you in is God's family, God's children. The Bible says people of the flesh are not the children of God in that sense. They're God's by creation, but not God's by regeneration. Now the new birth is God placing you, positionally speaking, out of Adam, in Christ. Now that happens the moment you're saved. I was born many years ago out here in Madison County. And the night I was born out there, and usually in those days when the doctors had to come from the little town out in the country to be with the mother to give birth to a child, it usually happened around 1 o'clock in the morning when it was pouring down rain or snowing or sleeting. That's usually whenever something like that happens. So I don't know. I think maybe I might have been born about maybe 12 o'clock when it was sleeting and snowing. And the doctor had to come in the buggy and he stayed there with my mother maybe many, many hours. And I was born into the world the first time into the Edwards family. But later on, I was born, I experienced another birth, and the other birth I experienced was a spiritual one. I was born of the water the first time in that sense, and then the second time I was born of the water and the Spirit, the Word and the Spirit. I was born of the water and the flesh then. Second time, the Word and the Spirit. I had nothing to do with that first birth. Not a thing in the world I had to do with that. I was born into this world. I didn't ask to come into this world. As I said, I was a heavyweight, weighed 3.5 pounds, but I didn't ask to come here. I was born here by my mother. She placed me here. My mother and dad was responsible for me being here. I had nothing to do with that. I also had absolutely nothing to do with being born into God's family. My last birth, my second birth, was a birth from God Almighty. The Holy Spirit and the Word of God put me in the family of God. Amen. It is true I had to come to the place where I wanted to be saved, and you will too. You'll never be saved until you come to the place where you want to be saved. Now it is the Spirit of God that begins to get you in that position. The Spirit of God through the preached Word of God disturbs you. That's what we call conviction, Holy Ghost conviction of sin. Unless there's Holy Ghost conviction of sin, people are not really born again. There's some church members right now, some of them got the name on this church roll, sitting out there in the radio listening. Oh, yeah, I'm talking to you now. You listen to what I have to say out there. I'm talking to you. You got your name on this church roll. You're sitting there, and you know you ought to be here in the house of God. You have no desire to be here this morning. You could have been here, but you're not here because you have no desire to be here. It may be you're still lost and on the road to hell, because people that are saved have a desire to come to the house of God. And if you don't have that desire, you may be a lost sinner. And don't you depend upon your name being on this church road to get you to heaven. You may end up in hell. You've been born again. If you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb, you have that desire to be in the house of God. Now, I was born into the family of God, and when God placed me into His family, I became a child of God. I had no desire, no concern whatsoever for the things of God until I was born into the family of God. Now, from the time I was born the first time and I was born the second time, I was attached to this world. The older I became, the more I loved the world and the pleasures of this world. By the time I was born the second time, I was so entwined and so wrapped up in the pleasures of this world, and this world held so much attraction for me, and I did not want to give it up. In fact, I ran from God for about 2 years. For about 2 years, I dodged the church. I dodged the preacher. I stayed away from God's people because I loved the world and the things of the world. I did not want to give them up. I had no desire for the Bible. I had no desire for church. I had no desire to be with God's people. Now, if you want to make me miserable, you just let the preacher come around, and I was miserable. And to tell you the truth, I'm ashamed of this now. If I saw him coming before he got there, I wasn't at home when he got there. Now, that's a dirty thing to do and a bad thing to do, and I'm not recommending that. It happens a lot of times. But I couldn't stand to be in the presence of a man of God. He made me tremble in my boots. And if someone got me to go to the house of God, when they gave the invitation for somebody to come down and be saved, I would have to actually hold to the back of the pew to stand up, because I felt if I turned that pew loose, I would fall. That's the way the Spirit of God was after me. And for 2 years, I ran from God. And then at one time, I was working on the night shift. I had to go right by the Westview Baptist Church in Greenville to go to work. And lo and behold, I'd go by that church to go to work. There'd be a bunch of deacons and the preacher, some men in the base of that church praying. And they'd be praying for me and praying for the lost sinners. And my head rise on my head, and I'd tiptoe by that church scared to death, because those men were calling on God, and I actually trembled as I went by there. I ran from God until one day God struck me down and put me flat on my back so I could run no more. And while I was flat on my back, my precious mother, who's in heaven rejoicing today, came from Georgia over to visit us to help us out during the time of my affliction. And my dear mother prayed for me, and she wanted to see me saved. And she was there one afternoon, and the old preacher man, most humble man of God, most Christ-like preacher I've ever known, that had been praying for me and I'd been running from him. And he came in with his Bible. He sat down, he read that Bible, and he talked with me. And then he said, "Virgil, don't you think it's about time that you're surrendering to God?" And I began to weep. And my mother, God bless the sweet memory, she walked over and she placed her arms around my neck and she bathed my face with her tears. And she said, "Son, you'll never find a better time than now to give your heart to Jesus. Won't you say yes to the Lord? Won't you say yes?" I raised my hand. I said, "Yes, I'll say yes." And that very moment, I turned from this world. You may say, "Preach Edwards, did the new birth take place right there at that moment?" I don't know. I know I turned from the world at that moment. I didn't know a thing in the world about the Bible, anything else. I did the best I knew how. I don't know what it took place that minute, or 5 minutes later, or 10 minutes later, an hour or two later, a day or two, a week. I don't know. I know that was a time. And I said an eternal yes, and turned from the world to God. One thing I know now is that I'm saved. But I couldn't tell you I was born again that very second, because the new birth is of God, and it's God that performs that new birth in your heart. Salvation is entirely of the Lord. He's the one that births you into the family of God, and he's the one that quickens you. There's been a lot of people that whenever you gave the invitation, the moment they got up to come to the altar, God saved them right then. Yeah. They were born again right then. They came down the altar and repented and read the Bible, and the man told them what to do to be saved. But God saved them before they got up good. God was looking on their heart. There's been others that's come down to the altar, and they made a profession and read the Bible, and people prayed with them and did what the man said to do to be saved, but they weren't saved right there. They begin to think about that thing, begin to come back to church, and God began to get a hold of them, and somewhere along the way, they really got in on it. The Holy Ghost gave birth to their souls. They might not continue the exact second or moment. See, God is sovereign. The wind bloweth where it listeth, thou hearest the sound thereof, cannot tell whence it cometh, where it goeth. So is everyone that's born of the Spirit. You can't tell the Spirit what to do. You can't tell God what to do. It's God that quickens you. It's the Spirit of God that regenerates you, and he's sovereign. And the Spirit of God quickens and makes you alive and places you in the body of Christ. Amen. Sinful man must be born again. The Word of God demands you must be born again. The nature of God's family demands you must be born again. Now, I told you a moment ago, I didn't like to be around Christians. I didn't like to be around preachers. I didn't like to go to church before God saved me. But listen to me. Are you listening? Hear me and hear me well. When God Almighty saved my soul, I wanted to be with God's people. I wanted to go to church. I wanted to read the Bible. I then began to love the things of God. That's what happened. And if you don't love God and the things of God and the house of God and the people of God and the fellowship of God, you better check up. You may be going as straight to hell as a Martin to his gourd on that downward road. You need to realize the nature of God's family demands you be born again. After I was born again, you know what I did? I said, hey, how about that prayer meeting crowd? I want to get with them. I said, hey, how about that Sunday school going crowd? I want to join them. I said, hey, how about that preaching crowd? I want to get in on that. Brother, I got in on it. Every time the church doors opened, I was right there. My wife can verify that fact. I was right there. I had to do that. The devil is after me, and if I wasn't right there, that'd just give him another chance to make a strike at me during the next week. I knew I had to stay at God's filling station and keep the gas tank full. I knew that. And the reason you have so many people wearing the knees out, coming to God to see the pants out sliding from God, they don't stay in the Bible, they don't stay on their knees, they don't stay in the house of God, they don't come to church like they ought to, they don't witness, they don't pray, and the devil keeps them defeated 7 days a week. Brother, you got to get in on it. Get in God's house. Get on your knees. Get in the Word of God. Get with God's people and quit playing around about it. That's the only way it can be done. And when you're born again, that desire is placed in your heart. And God places it. The nature of heaven demands a new birth. If some drunk could go to heaven without being born again, the first thing you start looking for up there would be a liquor store. If some gambler could go to heaven without being born again, he'd hunt a gambling dive. This rock and roll crowd, long head gang, if they could go to heaven without being born again, they'd start looking for the Rolling Stones and fellas like that up there, but they wouldn't find them there, and they're just not there. Listen to me, beloved. When you're born again, you're changed. And the nature of heaven demands that you be born again. And when you're born again, you have a new nature imparted unto you, and you become a child of God placed in the family of God. I haven't any more than half finished this message and not going to be able to finish it completely this morning. But I've said enough to let you know that you need to be born the second time or you won't go to heaven. Jesus said, Nicodemus, you must be born again. 7 years ago, I was in a meeting in Valdosta, Georgia. In that church there was a little lady that was very active. And she taught the juniors and sang with them, and she played one of the instruments, and oh, she was the most active little woman in the church. I thought within myself, that woman, I believe, must be about one of the best members here. She seemed like she's just so active and so concerned. And so I preached that week. And then one night I preached on the new birth. It was on about Friday night, I believe. I preached on the new birth. And the next night we were to have supper in her home. And when we arrived at her home, I noticed eyes red and swollen. I thought, well, there's something wrong. She's had some problems, or maybe she's not feeling well. And she didn't say very much. And after supper that night, she said to the pastor, said, "Pastor, can I talk with you and Preacher Edwards for a few moments alone?" The pastor said, "Yeah." We went into the living room and she began to cry. She said, "You know, I was a Methodist and attended the Methodist church all of my childhood days until I was grown. And then I married a Baptist. And said, I joined the Baptist church and I was baptized. And I've been very active in the Baptist church since that time. And I have small children here." But said, "Did you know last night when Preacher Edwards preached on the new birth, I realized for the first time in my life that I'd never been born again. I'd tried to be a good woman, a good wife, good to my family, a good church member, live a clean life, but I had never been born again. And I realized that for the first time," as she began to weep. She said, "I want to be born again more than anything in the world." That preacher said, "Get on your knees." She got on her knees. We began to pray and she looked to God, and God gave birth to her soul. The next morning when I left, I closed out on Sunday morning. And after the Sunday morning service, she came to me with tears in her eyes. She said, "Preacher Edwards, I'm so glad God sent you here for this meeting." She said, "I've been a church member all my life and on the road to hell. And if God hadn't have sent you here to bring that message on the new birth, I might have died and gone to hell." With tears in her eyes, she shook my hand. I walked away. I said, thank God I brought that message on the new birth. Let me ask you a question. Have you been born again? Let's stand. Our Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it to thy glory. May thy name be honored. May Jesus be glorified. Our Father, I pray today if there's someone here that's never been born again, that they might right now repent and receive Jesus as their Savior. May the dear Savior be glorified doing this invitation. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Now listen to me just a moment and then we're going home. If you're here unsaved, you've never been born again. Or if you're here today and you want to come back to God, you've been saved, but you've got cold and indifferent. You want to come back into fellowship with God, you may. Or if you're here and you want to unite with this church and we receive members, you may do that. Or for any other reason that you feel you ought to come forward and let me help you, I want you to respond to the invitation while they play on the instruments. Say these words, they're going to play one other stanza and we go into my response. When you reach age of accountability, and I don't know when you reach that age in your life, that depends upon your intelligence and your background and whatnot. Some come to the age of accountability age 4 and 5, some at 7 or 8, some at 9 or 10, 11 or 12. I don't know when you reach age of accountability, but when you reach age of accountability, you naturally begin to go down the broad road to destruction. And after you reach age of accountability, there's no way, absolutely no way for you to go to heaven except you be born again on this earth. No way. If God should let one person that's past age of accountability into heaven without being born again, every inmate in hell that died without the second birth would rise up and say, "You ingest God. You let one in and didn't let us in, and God's not going to let the first one in." Not the first one. You'll have to be born again or you'll go to hell as certain as I'm speaking to you today. While they play now, would you come if anybody needs to come this morning? A few years ago, Brother Wheelis, he's disabled to be here this morning. He's one of our members. He loves God. He had been a Methodist all his life. He came out, he heard me preach on the new birth. On the way back home, he started crying. His wife said, "What's the matter, you Pat?" He said, "If that preacher told the truth, I'm going to hell. I've never been born again." And I told the truth, and he got born again, and he's on the way to heaven now. You don't get born again in Methodist churches anymore because there's no gospel preached there. You'll die and go to hell if you depend on what you hear in a Methodist church or some of these other apostatized denominations. If you've never been born again, you need to get born again.